नेक्स्ट टर्म रिगार्डिंग द स्काई वेव प्रोपगेशन इज द क्रिटिकल फ्रीक्वेंसी. सो द क्रिटिकल फ्रीक्वेंसी फॉर अ गिवन लेयर इज द हाइएस्ट फ्रीक्वेंसी दैट विल बी रिटर्न्ड डाउन टू अर्थ बाय दैट लेयर आफ्टर हैविंग बीम स्ट्रेट अप एट इट. सो हाउ इट विल स्ट्रेट अप एट इट व्हेन द एंगल इज 90 डिग्री. So it is going straight upwards and is coming straight downwards without the angle of incidence and angle of reflection is 0 degree. So in that case, that frequency is called as the critical frequency. So it is important to realize that there is such a maximum and it is also necessary to know its value under a given set of condition, since this value changes with these conditions. A wave will be bent downwards provided that the rate of change of ionization density is sufficient and that this rate of ionization is measured per unit wavelength. So the bending back of the electromagnetic wave is totally dependent upon the ionization density. It follows that the closer to being vertical the incident ray, the closer to being vertical the incident ray, the more it must be bent to be returned to the earth by the layer. So the result of these effects can be twofold. First, the higher the frequency, the shorter is the wavelength, and it is less likely that this change in ionization density will be sufficient for refraction. Second, closer to vertical a given incident, the less likely it is returned to the ground. Means, if the transmitted wave is near to the angle of incident ray, then there is less likely that it will return to the ground. Either way, this means that a maximum frequency must exist above which the rays go through the ionosphere. So when the angle of incidence is normal, the name given to this maximum frequency is critical frequency, and its value ranges from 5 to 12 megahertz for F2 layer. Now this maximum usable frequency is very important term if it is used for a specific application. So the maximum usable frequency, or MUF, it is a limiting frequency. It is a limiting frequency, but this time for some specific angle of incidence other than normal. So if the angle of incidence between the incident ray and the normal is theta, it follows that the maximum usable frequency is equals to the critical frequency divided by cos theta. So how to define the maximum usable frequency? The maximum usable frequency is defined as the ratio of critical frequency to the cos theta. And what is theta? Theta is the angle of incidence. So solving it, we get critical frequency fc sec theta. So maximum usable frequency is equals to critical frequency sec theta. So what is sec theta? It is inverse of cos theta. This is also called as secant law, and it is very useful in making the calculations for the specific maximum usable frequency. So the secant law is applicable only to a flat earth surface and a flat reflecting layer. But we know earth surface is not flat, neither the reflecting layer, that is the ionosphere. Both the surfaces are not flat. Now the angle of incidence is of not so important, because it is determined by the distance between the points that are to be joined by the sky wave link. Thus, we can again define maximum usable frequency in terms of two such points rather than in terms of angle of incidence at the ionosphere. So now, what is maximum usable frequency? Maximum usable frequency is defined as the highest frequency that can be used for sky wave communication between the two given points on the earth. So what is the maximum usable frequency? If there is a transmitter and a receiver separated by a given distance, and if the frequency is transmitted and it is returned back to the earth's surface at the transmitter, then that frequency is now called as the highest frequency or the maximum usable frequency. Means wherever the sky wave communication is possible, if it is reflected by the ionosphere, that frequency which is used is called as maximum usable frequency. So to tell one thing, I will just draw in short. So if these are two points, so this is transmitter point and this is a receiver point, and if this is ionized layer, okay, so these are the two points, transmitter point and receiver point. The frequency I am transmitting and whatever it is receiving from this ionosphere layer. So the highest frequency that can be used for sky wave communication between these two given points on earth is called as maximum usable frequency. So it follows that it is quite obvious that there is a different value of maximum usable frequency for each pair of points on the globe, because the height of the ionosphere is variable around the globe. It is variable as per the height of the earth surface. Somewhere there are elevations, mountains. So if our transmitter and receivers are located at the mountain peaks or tall mass, then obviously MUF is going to change. Then the height of the ionospheric layers which reflects the electromagnetic waves also differs. During the daytime it is different height, during the night time the height is again different. So there is a different value of maximum usable frequency for each pair of point on the globe. So the normal values of maximum usable frequency ranges from 8 megahertz to 35 megahertz. And because of unusual solar activity, they rise to around 50 megahertz. The highest working frequency between a given pair of points is naturally made less than the maximum usable frequency. Next term is the skip distance. So what is the skip distance? It is the shortest distance from a transmitter measured along the surface of the earth at which the sky wave of fixed frequency, which is obviously more than the critical frequency, that will return to the earth. So it is the shortest distance. Shortest distance from a transmitter and the wave which will be reflected back to the earth's surface, and the point is on the earth. So the distance between the point on the earth and from where it is transmitted, so where the point where the wave is received and where it is transmitted, the shortest distance is known as the skip distance. We will understand with the help of this diagram. So in this diagram, suppose I have transmitted frequencies from this point T. Suppose this is point T, that is a transmitter point. I have transmitted the frequency, and suppose it is reflected by the various layers of the ionosphere. Say a ray number 3 is first reaching the earth's surface at say point X. Then this distance between the point T and X is the skip distance. So it is the shortest distance, because after that also the rays are receiving to the some other points. The shortest distance where the rays will be received when it is reflected by the ionospheric layer, that distance is called as the skip distance, shortest distance. So there should be minimum distance, and this minimum distance may be somewhat annoying for us. So one must expect there to be the maximum distance as limited by the curvature of Earth. But nevertheless, a definite minimum also exists for any fixed transmitting frequency. The point here is that if the skip distance is located very nearer to the transmitter, then it will be of no use. We can directly communicate message by orally. So we are very much uncertain. So this minimum distance must be considered in such a way that it is of worthwhile to set up a transmitter and receiver, considering the height of the ionospheric layer. So in this diagram, there are, again we can see, there are escaped rays, lower rays and upper rays. Now what are the meaning of escaped rays? So escaped rays are those frequencies which escapes into the layer which is above the ionospheric layer. Means this ionospheric layer will not reflect this electromagnetic frequencies. So which will be not reflected, they are called as escaped waves. So the rays which are properly reflected by the ionospheric layer are called as upper layers. So here the density of ionospheric layer is high, and the rays reflected by this dense ionospheric layer is called as upper layers. What are lower layers? Lower rays means those rays which will be the reflected by the lower layer of ionosphere. What are the lower layers? D layer or E layer during the night time. So these layers reflect the rays, and that are called as lower rays. And above the D layer and E layer, the F layer, if it is reflected by F layer, then these rays are called as upper rays. Ray number 6 is the upper ray. Ray number 2 and ray number 1 is called as lower rays. Ray number 5 and 6 are called as escaped rays. So when the angle of incidence is made quite large for ray 1, here the angle of incidence is very large. I'll show you in color so that it will be easy to understand. So here when the angle of incidence is made quite large for this ray 1. This is the angle of incidence. The sky wave returns to the ground at a, obviously the distance is longer. So if angle of incidence is large, the sky wave returns to the ground at longer distance from the transmitter. So as the angle is slowly reduced, the wave returns closer and closer to the transmitter as shown by ray number 2 and ray number 3. So as in this diagram, this ray number 2 and 3, if you look at the angle, I will use a different color. So this is third and this is second. So here it is number 3. This is number 2 and this is number 1. So angle 1, that is incident angle 1, is greater as compared to incident angle 2 and 3, and hence the waves are returning closer and closer to the transmitter. So if the angle of incidence is now made significantly less than that of ray 3, the ray will be too close to the normal to return the earth. It may bend noticeably as for ray number 4 or slightly 5 as that ray 5. So in either case, the bending will be insufficient to return the wave unless the frequency being used for communication is less than the critical frequency. In that case, everything is returned to the earth. If critical frequency is transmitted, means everything will be returned back to the earth when the angle of incidence is normal. Normal means we are transmitting directly, means I will transmit and the ray will be returned back at the same time. Here the angle of incidence is normal. Finally, if the angle of incidence is just smaller than that of ray 3, the wave will be returned but at a distance farther than the return point of ray 3. A ray such as this is ray number 6. So here, if you see the ray number 6, the angle of incidence is just smaller than that of 3. So this upper ray is bent back very gradually because ion density is changing very slowly at this angle. So for ray number 6, the ion density is changing very, very gradually. Therefore, there is a very gentle variation in the angle of incidence. It thus returns to earth at a considerable distance from a transmitter and is weakened by its passage. So as it is returning back, its power or energy is getting weakened. Ray 3 is incident at an angle which results in its being returned close to the transmitter as a wave of this frequency can be. So accordingly, this, the smaller the angle of the incidence, the distance gets shorter, and this shorter distance is called as the skip distance. Thus, it follows that for any higher frequency that is beamed up at the angle of ray 3 will not be returned to the ground. Means we are, if increasing the frequency above which the ray 3 is, say for an example, if I'm increasing the frequency say more than 51 hertz, means the ray will not return to the earth. This ray number 3, if it is less than 51 hertz, it will return to the earth. It is seen that frequency which makes a given distance corresponds to skip distance is the maximum usable frequency for that pair of point. So anything, any frequency which is returning back more than at a point more than skip distance, then that will be the maximum usable frequency. At the skip distance, only the normal or lower ray can reach the destination. Whereas at a greater distances, the upper rays can be received as well. But if these upper rays are receiving, then it will cause interference. As we can see, the lower rays are there and the rays which are coming in a skip distance, in between them are the upper rays. So these upper rays will create interference. That is the ray number 6 is creating interference. Here it is creating interference because the variation in the ionization density is very, very gradual. So the angle of incidence is very gradual. This is the reason why frequency not below the maximum usable frequency are used for transmission. Another reason is that why the frequencies not below the maximum usable frequencies are used is the lack of the directional antennas. So this is a design problem that we are not having highly directional antennas for high frequencies. So if the directionality problem exists for a high frequency antennas, the range for the maximum usable frequency is limited. Means we cannot use higher frequencies above MUF. Now if frequency used is low enough, it is possible to receive lower rays by two different paths after either one or two hops as shown in this figure. So here you can see that the frequency is hopping. So this is the first hop, this is the second hop. So this hopping can be dangerous because it will again result in interference, because this transmitted frequency is lower than the maximum usable frequency. The transmission path is limited by again the skip distance at one end, and again it is limited by the curvature of earth. So the transmission path is limited by skip distance as well as it is limited by the curvature of earth. So as we can see, this two hops I'll show in the colorful way so that it will be easy to understand. So this is hop number 1 and this is hop number 2, this point. So if I am transmitting one frequency which is lesser than the MUF, then hopping will take place and this frequency is returned here. Say the frequency, suppose F1. And suppose I am using another frequency and it is having a single hop, say I will say point number 3, and this frequency is different, suppose f2, then obviously these different frequencies are receiving at this same point, so this will result in interference. So why this interference is occurring? Because of multiple hops. We can say a two-path reception. Path 1 because of the actual usable frequency, and second because of 1 and 2, that is multiple hop. This is because the frequency is low, and hence they will receive at the same point R, and F1 and F2 frequency will cause an interference. Now in this figure we can see that the longest single hop distance is obtained when the ray is transmitted tangentially to the surface of the earth. Tangential. So maximum single hop if a ray is transmitted tangentially to the surface of earth. So this is surface of the earth, and if we transmit the frequency tangentially, the distance is maximum. So I will show you again. So this is the frequency I am transmitting single hop at say point A. It will receive at this point single hop. So the longest single hop distance is obtained when a ray is transmitted tangentially to the surface of Earth. Tangential. Okay. These rays are tangent. Tangent to the curvature of Earth. These rays are tangent to the curvature of Earth. What is the meaning of tangential? So I will show you again. So if this is curvature and if this is a ray, tangent ray. So this is a tangent ray. This is Earth's surface. Okay. So the longest single hop distance is obtained when this ray is transmitted tangentially to the surface of the Earth. For F layer, this corresponds to the maximum practical distance of about 4000 kilometers. So if the transmitted and received rays are tangential to the Earth's surface and if they are reflected by F layer, then this total distance covered in a single hop is around 4000 kilometers. It's such a huge distance. It is more than the distance traveled by ground wave propagation. Since the semicircumference of the Earth is just over 20,000 kilometers, multiple hop paths are often required. So here we can say that multiple hopping can be also done because Earth's semicircumference is around 20,000 kilometers. So no unusual problems arises with the multiple hop north-south path. North-south path. However, care must be taken when planning long east-west path to realize that although it is day here, it might be night if there happens to be on the other side of the terminator. So while planning, if you want to transmit the frequency, we must not forget that there is a time difference from east to west direction. Means it is there is a time delay over the Earth surface. So we can say that if the time at India is around day time, it's say 12 o'clock, then it happens that at US the time is around 8 o'clock in the evening. So this may cause the variations in the ionospheric layer. The layer of ionosphere in Earth is different and the height of the ionosphere in US is different. So obviously there is a problem in the reflection and the transmission problem. Means there will be obvious problem when a ray is transmitted from a transmitter located in India during the daytime and the receiver which receives the signal which is located at America during the night time. In both the condition there is a variation in the height of the ionosphere and hence it is possible that the rays will not be properly received at the receiver end. The result of not taking this into account is shown in, so in this figure, if we have not planned that what is the time at the eastern part and what is the time in the western part, means suppose in the east here it is day and night in the western parts, then problem arises, that the problem of interference. It is shown in this figure. So a path calculated on this basis of constant height of the F1 layer crosses the terminator and it will miss the receiving area as shown in the F layer over the target is lower than the F. See, so in here the transition is taking place. What is the actual distance? This is the actual distance. I will show you by colors, so it will be easy to understand. So we have not planned well. Now the height of the F1 layer is different. Suppose this is the terminator, means where a day and night is going to coincide. So if we have not done the planning properly, so there is obviously there is mismatch of this height, of this distance, say dx. What is the actual distance? Say suppose this is the actual distance, but now what is the distance where it is receiving? So this, so here the rays have missed the target by a distance dx. Means whatever the information we have transmitted, it is of no use because receiver is located some at other distance and the rays are received at some other distance. So this problem occurs. The undershoot will occur. So this is undershooting because it is receiving prior to the receiver, before the receiver. So this is undershooting. So in each case it is due to the interference between the two waves which left the same source but arrived at a destination by different path. So at the daytime it will receive at different path and at the night time it will receive at different receiver. So because the signal received at any instant is the vector sum of all the waves received, alternate cancellation and reinforcement will result if there is length variation as large as the half wavelength between any two points. So there will be the cancellation of the signals takes place if the wavelength is the factor of half of the wavelength of the frequencies being transmitted. It follows that such fluctuations is more likely with smaller wavelengths than the higher wavelengths. So now, as there is mismatch, then we have one more term, fading. So what is fading? Fading is the fluctuation in the signal strength at a receiver. What is fading? It is the fluctuations in the signal strength at the receiver. It may be rapid, it may be slow, it may be general, or it may be frequency selective. So simply, fading is the fluctuation in the signal strength at the receiver. It is just because of the interference between the two waves which left the same source but arrived at the destination by different path. Here, as we can see in this diagram, different path. This is another path, this is another path. Dotted line and solid line. So because the signal received at instant is the vector sum of all the waves received, cancellation will result. The fluctuation is more likely with smaller wavelength than the higher frequencies. So as we can see that here the fading can occur because of the interference between the lower and the upper rays of the sky wave, between the sky waves arriving by different number of hops or different paths. So here the path is different, as we can see, multiple path. This is a two hopping. The hopping may be single also, from here to here, if the rays are tangential, or even between a ground wave and a sky wave. If we are using a lower frequencies, then there might be interference because of ground wave propagation and sky wave propagation at the lower end of high frequency band. So fading may also occur if a single sky wave is being received because of the fluctuations of the height or density in the layer of reflecting the wave. So if in this situation, if the height of the ionosphere varies, then also the fading will take place. If two different paths are followed by the same wave, then also the fading will take place. If ground waves and sky waves are propagating and receiving at the same point, then also the fading will take place. So to avoid this, one of the more successful means of combating fading is to use space or frequency diversity. Means we have to use different frequencies for different types of propagation and for different applications. Then only the problem of fading can be avoided. So if fading is frequency selective, it is quite possible for adjacent portions of the signal to fade independently, although their frequency separation is only a few hertz. So frequency selective fading occurs more likely at the highest frequencies for which the sky waves are used. So frequency selective fading can cause a very tremendous problems, or we can say havoc. Havoc means very big problems when the reception of AM signals are distorted by the frequency selective fading. Means we are transmitting the ground waves at lower frequencies, means we are using for AM signal transmission or reception, and the nearby frequencies are also used for sky wave propagation. And if interference takes place, then there is complete loss of the information. So single sideband transmission suffers less fading, and it is generally used, single sideband transmission, because relative amplitude of only one portion of the signal received is changing constantly. The effect of fading on radio telegraphy is to introduce errors, and diversity is used here wherever it is possible. So the fading will obviously introduce errors in the transmission of radio waves or radio frequencies or high frequencies. So frequency diversities must be used. So what we are discussing? We are discussing the causes of fading and we are discussing the possible solutions of the fading. To avoid fading, what can be done? Next point is optimum working frequency. So what is optimum working frequency? The frequency which is being used mostly for a particular transmission and which have been predicted to be used over a particular period of time over a given path is termed as optimum working frequency. It is very simple. It means that the frequency which we are using mostly for a particular transmission and for a longer period of time over the dedicated path, that frequency is termed as optimum working frequency. Which parameters are considered? Frequently used frequency, the frequency which is used for a particular period of time, and the frequency which is traveling for a dedicated path. That frequency is called as the optimum working frequency. Next is the inter-symbol interference. What is the inter-symbol interference? It occurs commonly in communication system and it is the main reason for signal multipath propagation. So when signals arrived at the receiving stations via different propagation path, they cancel out each other, which is known as the phenomena of signal fading. Here it should be remembered that the signals cancel out themselves in a vector and not scalar. Vector means directional cancellation. Skin depth. So the electromagnetic waves are not suitable for underwater propagation. However, they can propagate underwater provided we make the frequency of propagation extremely low. So if the frequency is very, very low, then we can make them to propagate under the water also. You have heard the word sonar. Here in sonar technology, sound navigation and ranging. Sonar means sound navigation and ranging. In this underwater, we are transmitting the frequencies and detecting the objects, detecting the speed of that objects. It is specially used in marine or naval applications under the sea surface or under the water. Condition apply, the frequency is very, very low, which is called as extremely low frequency, ELF. So the attenuation of electromagnetic waves underwater is expressed in terms of skin depth. Hence, skin depth is defined as the distance at which the signal is attenuated by 1 upon E. So this is an attenuation factor. So it is a measure of depth to which an electromagnetic wave can penetrate. It is the, what is skin depth? Skin depth is a measure of depth to which electromagnetic wave can penetrate. How much the electromagnetic waves can penetrate in the water, that is called as skin depth. So skin depth is represented by the symbol delta. So this is all about the various terms and definitions which is used in sky wave propagation. So here, sky wave propagation is basically the propagation of waves which is because of the reflection of the electromagnetic waves by the ionospheric layer. This is about the sky wave propagation.